davenports and kettle drums, swallowtail coats, tablecloths, and patent leather shoes, bathing suits and bowling balls, and clarinets and rings. Well, this radio really needs is a fuse. A tinker, a tailor, a soldier's things, his rifle, his boots, full of rocks. Oh, and this one is for bravery. When this one.
Jarhead, a 2005 film directed by Sam Mendes, is based upon the memoir of Anthony Swofford, a Marine Scout sniper sent to Kuwait who is played by Jake Gyllenhaal. The story begins in 1989 as Swofford begins his journey of becoming a Marine, which he quickly learns probably wasn't the smartest decision he's ever made. After completing basic training, Swofford is sent to Camp Pendleton, California to train to be a scout sniper, where he proves to stand out among his fellow candidates. Upon completion of Scout Sniper School, Swofford is dragged into a new war with Iraq when President Bush sends troops to Kuwait as part of Operation Desert Shield, where he learns how different this war is compared to the stories he's heard from veterans of previous conflicts. The film focuses primarily on the psychological impact boredom has on the situation the Marines have found themselves in. Little action is seen throughout the film, done intentionally by Mendes to express the end of an era of conventional warfare. The movie itself does a great job at capturing the sense of uselessness and envy the Marines feel as they watch their country's Air Force steamroll the Iraqi army. Eventually, Swofford's deployment ends without him getting a single kill after the United States pulls out of Kuwait.
WTLV 12, Jacksonville.
You're seeing the first pictures showing the destruction following the Iraqi invasion of Kuwait.
We've heard reports of murders and rapes blamed on Iraqi soldiers, but these are the first images of the war-torn area.
On August 2nd, 1990, the nation of Iraq, carried out by Saddam Hussein's army, launched an invasion into Kuwait, a country located in eastern Arabia in between Iraq and Saudi Arabia. This invasion subsequently started a deployment of a NATO coalition force consisting of the United States, United Kingdom, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and France to Kuwait. This maneuver would be known as Operation Desert Shield. 6 months after the initial invasion of Kuwait, the coalition forces gave Hussein the choice to withdraw his troops or be removed by force. On January 17, 1991, the coalition force began their bombardment and massive ground assault of almost 1 million troops. This operation would be known as Operation Desert Storm. The American public watched in awe as CNN ran their iconic night optic footage of the Iraqi soldiers returning fire with anti-aircraft and Scud missiles in retaliation.
This is, something is happening outside. The skies over Baghdad have been illuminated. We're seeing bright flashes going off all over the sky.
Iraq's Scud program would prove to be effective only when used in large quantities, because the modifications they made to extend the range and damage would significantly reduce accuracy. This primary air assault of Desert Storm would be preceded by a ground assault, which included a massive armor campaign, main battle tanks, infantry fighting vehicles, attack helicopters, and fighter jets, all engaged in head-to-head combat. Although the Iraqi army swiftly outnumbered NATO in armor, the T-62 and T-72s up against the American M1 and M1A1 Abrams main battle tanks, accompanied with other armor on both sides, proved to be a quick and decisive victory for the coalition force. The war in Kuwait would officially end by February of 91, leaving the Iraqi army defeated with roughly 30,000 killed and 80,000 captured, while the coalition forces suffered 292 casualties and 776 wounded. The coalition troops would have a complete withdrawal by March of that year. The uniforms portrayed in this movie can be interpreted in many different ways. While the story follows Marine Corps scout snipers during the Gulf War, there are many other troops from other branches and divisions within the United States military, such as the 82nd and 101st Airborne Divisions of the United States Army, and other divisions within the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Coast Guard. While many different gear components were used during this conflict, most troops were utilizing the iconic six-color desert uniform, Alice webbing, and Pasgit systems, as well as other pieces that we will go over. I'd encourage you to find reference photos or videos specific to units of different branches, and find out different standard operating procedures those units took to evenly distribute weight and enhance comfortability of their equipment. This guide will offer you the base of the most commonly seen equipment from reference photos and videos of the Gulf War. We will start with the base uniform, the six-color desert pattern uniform, also known as the chocolate chip pattern. This was a battle dress uniform that was used most by the Army and Marine Corps due to its practicality in the desert environment. In terms of the undershirts, you will generally see the Army wearing an issued brown cotton t-shirt, while Marines went with an OD green tee. Accompanied with the chacos, most were issued boonies in the same pattern, as well as jungle boots. A variety of boots are seen in photos, including the traditional black leather lace-up boots, the newly issued tan desert boots, but the jungle boots were still very common to see. Periodically, you'll even see palladiums. You may also be familiar with the Desert Night Parka. This iconic parka was worn during the first Gulf War to defeat most Soviet-manufactured night optics of the time, but was soon retired due to drastic improvements in night vision in the later years. Moving away from the base uniform, we'll take a look at the Pasgit components. Pasgit, meaning Personal Armor System for Ground Troops, was a helmet and armor program that was introduced to American troops in 1983, seeing service in conflicts such as Operation Urgent Fury in Grenada in 1983, and Operation Just Cause in Panama in 89. Natively, the Pasgit vests come in a woodland pattern, but six-color desert covers were commonly thrown over the vests once the Gulf War began. The Pasgit helmet, seen here, was given a chaco cover as well, although some reference photos show National Guard, military police, or Navy intelligence using woodland covers. Cat eye bands are often seen strewn around the helmets. They are used to reflect light to identify friendly personnel. It is also common to see troops with sun, wind, and dust goggles to protect against the sand and other harsh desert elements. Moving on to the load-bearing system, we get to the Alice webbing. Alice, meaning all-purpose lightweight individual carrying equipment, was introduced in the United States Army in the early 1970s, and is still occasionally seen in use by National Guard in training. The full base Alice system consists of the LC2 belt, suspenders, two 30-round magazine pouches, one compass and bandage pouch, two canteen pouches, and Alice or M56 butt packs. The LC2 belts, as seen here, were the most common. It is very easy to mix up the LC2 belts with either the LC1 or LC3s, so please make sure you get the LC2 belt. Other accessories seen on Alice equipment are M67 grenades, angle head flashlights, which fit on the sides of the Alice mag pouches, and the Vietnam-era M7 bayonets, which fit directly onto the belt. You may have been drawn to the iconic NBC suits that are mentioned frequently throughout the film. All troops during this conflict were given a variety of MOP equipment to protect them against potential chemical attacks by the Iraqi army. The two main components of the NBC gear are the M17A1 gas mask, fitted with the M17 gas mask bag with proper decontamination swabs, and an NBC suit. Included with the NBC suit are the boot covers and the two-layered glove system. Troops were often given the NBC suit in a plastic bag. These either came in an OD pattern or a woodland pattern. To wrap up this video, I will briefly go over the most commonly seen firearms. The standard issue rifle at this time for all frontline units would have been the M16A2. The A2 would be the successor to the A1, adding an adjustable rear sight, round handguard, and overall enhanced thickness. For support weapons, the most common would have been the FN Mini-Me, also known as the M249 Mark I, or the M60 machine gun. If you are interested in creating the same impression as Swofford, the weapon he was using was the M40 rifle. This rifle was a Quantico-modified Remington 700, and only saw use by the Marine Corps scout snipers at this time. Thank you all so much for watching. If you have any questions about proper rucks or how to set up your webbing properly, please feel free to DM me on Instagram or leave me a comment. Hope you all are doing well, and stay safe during this pandemic.